It says, we have come to understand how God's word is about the Lord Jesus Christ. He is everywhere in it and central to it, as Ephesians 1, 10 through 13 says. In the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom we also have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be, this is amazing, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ. And then they say, isn't it awesome that it is about the Lord Jesus that we get to participate in his inheritance? We are so thankful to finally understand it is about him, his free gift, not only because we are unable to do anything to save ourselves, but so that all the glory goes to Jesus Christ and that we can trust and rest in him. Isn't that awesome? You know, saints, that when Paul talks about the fellowship of the mystery, the fellowship that we share together, understanding who he has made us to be in Christ. So next Sunday, we'll be back right down the street of the Solid Building, back there. If you come here, you're welcome to come, but we won't be here. So we'll give you this one and go there. Just right down the street. There. We'll be back at the La Solid. And then after the membership lunch, if I could, a couple of guys after church, because all the stuff here, we're going to move it back over there. We're going to meet at 12:45. A couple of guys come and we'll load everything in the top. Kind of put it back in the other building. It shouldn't. So I'll request that way. Let's go on to the book of Colossians now, chapter number one. And if you look at number one, notice what it says here at verse 21. It says in Colossians 1:21, it says, and you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. Verse 22, and the body of his flesh through death. Now look at the next phrase. Here's again what we're focusing on, to present you. See that there? Since you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. So we're going to continue to talk about that today. Presented holy and without blame. Let me just erase this a little bit of room up here. All right. So we're going to continue to look at this phrase here, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Let's unite our prayer. God and Father, we thank you for the time to look into your word today and especially to once again focus on who we are in Christ and being presented, the fact that you're going to present us holy and without blame. Amen. All right, is this one not on? That's gonna bother me right there. It'd be better if it's over here, actually. As in, is it just not picking up the signal there? Or let's see. Okay. Let's do this. Yeah, that's gonna be a problem too. All right. Is that any better? Okay. The folks on the internet, is that sound any better? Let us know if it is. That would be helpful. Look over to again to Colossians in chapter number 1, and what I'll do is I'll try to stay somewhat close to the mic here, if that'll help. So in Colossians chapter number 1, you can see at verse 22, it says, in the body of his flesh through death, and then it says, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Everybody see that there? And we began to look at this in some detail last time. What I'd like you to do is go back with me to Ephesians 1. Look back at Ephesians 1. Look at Ephesians 1, verse 3 and 4. We did note this last week, so we'll kind of emphasize it again and move on. Look at Ephesians 1, verse 3. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ." And then here's why he did that. Verse 4. "According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world." And here's why. "That we should be," you see that? Say it with me, the rest of the verse. What? "Holy and without blame before him in love." Everybody see that there? Do you see how similar the phrase at the end of verse 4 is to Colossians 1:22? Does everybody see that? How they're not identical, but they're really conveying the same point. So in Colossians 1:22, "to present you holy, unblameable, and unreprovable in his sight." Now, if you go back to Ephesians 1, but hold Colossians, notice in Ephesians 1:4, "according as he hath chosen us in him." Now, what's the time reference there? Okay, everybody see that there? So you see how in that verse, the Holy Spirit, through the pen of the Apostle Paul, takes us back to before Genesis 1:1, before in the beginning, right? Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth." So in Genesis 1:1, that's when Jesus Christ, who is the member of the Godhead that actually spoke everything into existence, so he created matter, space, and time. But before he ever did any of that, he already had a plan and a purpose. So in Ephesians 1, when it says at verse 4, "according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world," so before Genesis 1:1, God had a plan and purpose to form a being. He calls it a new creature, that would be the perfect reflection of his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Everybody see that there? But then stay there in that verse. It says, "according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him." And before him is the idea in his presence, in love. So that part of the verse takes us into eternity future. You see how in that verse he takes us from before the foundation of the world to the ages to come. What is the church, the body of Christ, going to be like in the ages to come, according to verse 4? Holy and without blame in love. God is love, so meaning in God's presence. Ken, go ahead. You had a question or comment. Yes. What Ken is talking about is later on in the book of Ephesians. In fact, look at Ephesians 1 there. He's talking about, look with me at verse 19, Ephesians 1:19. It says, go back to verse 18. "The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling." So God has a calling in all this. "And what the riches of the glory of his inheritance," where? In the saints. That's us. God has an inheritance in us. That's kind of weird. What do you have to offer God? Wait a minute. He owns everything. What am I bringing to the table? How about nothing? But he has an actual inheritance in us, and that's what Ken was talking about, is that in the ages to come, he will have presented us as believers holy and without blame, and in his presence forever we will live forever in love, holy and without blame. Now, can anybody see a problem with this? We're not there yet. So you, every day you get up and you look in the mirror, you see a massive problem with it. And I didn't I didn't just insult everybody. Well, maybe I did, but I didn't. Just what I'm saying. That we all understand that we still have kind of a major conflict here. What's it called? It's called the flesh. It's called these bodies of sinful flesh, right? So something's got to give, right? And if God, if his intention is to present us holy and without blame in his presence in love and even unblameable, unreprovable, then something's got to happen that addresses and deals righteously with all of our actions and conduct that we did in our life as believers. Now, the moment you trusted the Lord Jesus Christ for your personal salvation, what did the justice of God do in relationship to all of your sins, all of our sins? He forgave them all. So all of your sins are already forgiven, all of them, past, present, and future. Is that good to know? Okay. In order for God to do that, he looks to Christ, to his work on our behalf. But as believers, do we sometimes maybe not make the right choice? Amen. Yeah, okay. We can say that with gusto. Amen! Right? Yeah. Sometimes we don't make the right choice. When you read the epistles of the Apostle Paul, you see he clearly calls many, many things out. For example, right here in Colossians, look at what he says in Colossians 3. Look over to Colossians chapter 3. Look at Colossians chapter number 3. Watch this. I'm going to start at verse 5 now, Colossians 3, 5. He says, mortify therefore. Mortify means what? What's that mean? Yeah, so put it to death, okay? Quit giving it life, right? So Colossians 3, 5, it says, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. And now watch him this list here. Fornication. Should we be doing any of that? How about uncleanness? Is that okay? How about inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, covetousness, which is idolatry? Is any of that stuff okay as believers that we should be involved in? He says, for which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience, in which also ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them. But now ye also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Is any of that stuff okay with God? But is it already forgiven? Since it is already forgiven, should we just go do it? God forbid. Exactly. So why should we, as believers now, make the conscious choice to put all that stuff away and stop doing it? It doesn't honor God. Excellent. Excellent. So first and foremost, it doesn't honor God. Why else? It's not who we are in Christ. And then, Ken, what did you say? Out of gratitude. Carly, you said the same thing, right? Gratitude, who we are in Christ. We live out of the love of Christ for us. We're not trying to gain or merit or maintain or earn the love of Christ. He loves us. So to live out of his love for us, to let that motivate us. So when the Apostle Paul appeals to the Colossians here with these issues, you can tell that they themselves were still having these problems, right? Why would he have to address them if they weren't struggling with these very issues? So when we as believers, if we find these things in our life and our conduct, how do you approach them? Well, you approach them objectively. You don't condemn yourself. Oh, woe is me. God, I promise I'll do better next time. Don't tell God lies. Every time you say, God, I promise I'll do better next time. Well, whatever. Why would you tell God something that is you basically saying you're having confidence in your flesh to do better? If we could do better, why do we need Christ? Right? You've heard me say that the title to this article that the guy wrote, this is several years ago that he sent this article out, the title of the article was The Foolishness of Trying Harder to Do Better. Because when you try harder to do better, where are you placing your confidence in? In self. Christ already is my Savior. He already is our life. So we don't want to try harder to do better. We want to learn to let Christ, who is our life, to be our life. Live out of him as our resource, right? So when it comes to things like these that Paul lists here, just like the Colossians were experiencing these, if we experience these things, we want to deal with them objectively and say, okay, no, that isn't who I am in Christ. That's not why God saved me. That is not an accurate reflection of who my Father is. So in the light of who he is to me, in light of his forgiveness, his love, let me address this problem objectively and then deal with it. You see how that sets you free. And you can approach it based upon true love and acceptance. God will never stop loving you. When will God stop loving you? In order for God to stop loving you, who does he first have to stop loving?
Himself.
Jesus Christ. And that's never going to happen. Wow. Man, that's good, isn't it? to know that, okay? So we're still at the same problem, though. And the problem is that if we have those things in our life that you see there in Colossians that they themselves had, then how can God present us holy, unblameable? It looks to me like they're blameable. They're blameworthy. So how can God do this? Well, he's going to take us through what the Apostle Paul calls the judgment seat of Christ. And what's going to happen at that time and that day and that event is that all those things that we did in our life as believers, remember, sin is already totally forgiven. So it's not going to be a judgment of whether or not you're going to heaven. What's going to happen at the judgment seat of Christ is all those things that we believed, that we said, that we did, that don't match his word, the righteousness of his word, it's going to be manifested to be wood, hay, and stubble. Now, what does fire do with wood, hay, and stubble? Burns it up. All those things that we did in our life, meaning that we let the scripture produce in our life. So again, it's not about us trying. All those things in our life where we let the scripture be the basis upon which we made a choice and faced the details of life, that match scripture, the judgment seat of Christ is going to manifest it to be what he calls gold, silver, precious stones. What does fire do to gold, silver, and precious stones? Purifies it. So what's the end result of the judgment seat of Christ going to be? That's exactly going to be the end result. That's why the judgment seat of Christ is necessary. That's why we're going to go through it. So let's do this then. Look over to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We're just going to touch on this for a few moments here. Look up. That is correct. So let's clarify that. What Barry just said, that this is a judgment for those who have truly trusted the Lord Jesus Christ for their salvation. So this particular judgment is not a judgment of whether you're going to go to heaven. The appearing at this judgment has nothing to do with whether or not you're already saved. If you appear at this judgment, you are saved. This is about people who are already saved. Forgiven of all their sins and are already saved. Okay? It's a judgment of believers. Notice at 1 Corinthians 3, look at the details here. We'll get, just kind of briefly mention a few things here. 1 Corinthians 3 says, I'm going to go back to verse 8. It says, now he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man shall receive his own, what's the next word there? Reward according to his own labor. Now, the reason I'm emphasizing that word there, reward, receiving, is because that's going to come up again in our context. Verse 9 says, for we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. So see in verse 9 that God is laboring and we're laboring with him. We're working with him. Now, there's a standard. He says, according to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder. You see, the wise master builder, think of it, the chief architect. He's the head foreman. He's the one to whom the blueprints have been given. And the blueprints are the dispensation of the grace of God. He says, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. Now, why would you lay a foundation? What are you doing if you're laying a foundation? You're building something. And you can see in our context, he talks about husbandry and building. So husbandry is a living, like a garden, as it were. And a building is a place to go and live in. And you see blueprints in verse 10. You see right at the end of verse 10, the last sentence, but let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. So see, there's kind of a warning here. I asked a question during the Sunday school class. I'll ask it again. How many of you have ever been involved in some kind of home remodel? Some kind, right? Did it come out like you thought? Some kind, right? Okay. Well, anyway, so if you've been involved in some kind of remodel and so forth, you understand that, assuming you followed the regulations, you actually went and got a blueprint and followed codes. Maybe we didn't. But anyway, that's another whole story, right? Okay. But so you go get architect, you draw the blueprints, you get the blueprints approved, you take those blueprints and give them to the general contractor, and you want to make sure they follow the blueprints is what's happening. The Lord Jesus Christ, when he saved Saul of Tarsus, Paul the Apostle, he gave to the Apostle Paul blueprints about, I stepped away from the mic, but he gave the Apostle Paul blueprints about the dispensation of grace. When he calls it the dispensation of grace, what do you think the theme of the blueprints are about? Grace. Wow. When he says he laid the foundation, and then he says another builds thereon, but let every man take heed how he builds thereupon. You see, the concern is, are you going to follow the blueprint when you build? There's the concern. Watch what he goes on to say. He says, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Christ, as Paul, laid the foundation. Now watch the details. Now if any man, what's the next word there? Build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or stubble. You see the two categories of building material. What's the nature of gold, silver, precious stone compared to the nature of wood, hay, and stubble? Yeah, one has intrinsic value. There is value to hay if you own cattle and horses. It has value, right? There's value to wood if you're going to build a house, right? But you can see the clear difference between gold, silver, precious stones. Those have intrinsic value and exceed in value compared to the wood, hay, stubble. Verse 13, every man's work. So in the context, what is the work referring to? Is work for salvation? Yes or no?
No.
It's not work for salvation, because you can't work for your salvation. Salvation is a free gift. It's work as a believer. You're building, you're laboring with God, you're working together, following the blueprints. Say that? Yes. Yes. James asks, is that the idea that the love of Christ constraineth us? That's exactly the motivation here. When he says, verse 13, every man's work shall be made manifest. For the day, that's going to be the day of this judgment when that occurs, shall declare it, that is his work. Because it, his work, shall be revealed by fire. The fire is the word of God, it's scripture. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. Let me say it this way. When we as believers stand before the judgment seat of Christ, what's going to happen is all the doctrine that we put into our soul, that we taught others, that we lived out of, that we spoke, that we expressed, all of it. Sometimes people will say, well, is that the doctrine or is it the works? Well, why are you separating them? Why are you acting like they're two different things? Doctrine teaches us how to live godly. So you don't want to separate them as though God's going to say, yeah, you got all the doctrine correct, but your life stunk, so this is all okay. No. The way we live, we are to live, how James says it, out of the love of Christ. The doctrines of grace teach us that. And so what's going to happen is this. When we appear at the judgment seat of Christ, God is going to take his word, scripture. And he's going to let scripture be the standard by which
he measures the doctrine that's in our soul and what we did with it. Anything that matches, it will be what? Gold, silver, precious stones. Anything that doesn't match, the word will manifest that it didn't meet code. And then the fire is going to burn it up. In the end, is that going to be good or bad?
Good.
Why is that good? It won't be there ever again to haunt you forever. Wow. So the end result of this is the body of Christ really is going to be presented holy and without blame, unblameable, because everything that was blameworthy that we did in our body as believers will have been burnt up. He says it this way. He says at verse 14, if any man's work abide, that is, abide the fire, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive, now what are the next two words? Notice, a reward. It's singular. That's why I mentioned the word reward back in verse 8. Go back to verse 8. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man, who does that include? You, me, shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. See that? So God is going to absolutely reward you based upon how you let the word of Christ dwell in you. Now, there's a whole lot of other things about that, but we're not going to get into it right now. Go back to verse 14. So if any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive what? A reward. If any man's work shall be burned, so first of all, before we go on, if it got burned, what was it? It was wood, hay, and stubble. So it didn't match the doctrine. So what's he going to experience? Suffer loss. Loss of what? The reward. So loss of his soul? You can't ever lose your soul if you're a believer, because all your sins are already forgiven. This is not a judgment of your sins. But you could have had the reward. And what determines whether it's gold, silver, I want to emphasize and repeat again what Brother James said a moment ago. What determines whether or not it's gold, silver, precious stones is we're motivated by the love of Christ. That's the motivation. We're not trying to labor in order, man, I'm going to show everybody what a great preacher I am. I'm going to show everybody what a great Christian I am. I'm going to show God how great a decision he made when he saved me. That's about self, right? That's all going to burn. That's right. Yeah. So I'm inviting everybody right now to my bonfire, okay? So, right? So it's not about us. It truly is about learning to live out of the grace of Christ, out of the sufficiency of God's word, out of Christ being our life. So when he says here at verse 15, if any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. That's loss of the reward that he could have had. But he himself shall be saved. See, he's not going to lose his soul, yet so as by fire. See that there? Yeah, she said you're going to smell like smoke, okay? So, all right. So, oh, man. What's that? Yeah. Don't walk around with lighter fluid in your pocket, right? He says, know ye not that ye are the temple of God? And we are. We're the dwelling place of God today, right? Know ye not that ye are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God. And in the context, the way that the temple of God gets defiled is he's preaching the wrong doctrine. And hence it's wood, hay, and stubble. It says, if any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. Well, he just said back at verse 15 that he's going to be saved. So you know in verse 17, the destroy is not the destruction of his soul. Think about it, guys. Life work. He's been preaching over a lifetime and he's not been preaching the right scripture, but he's a saved person. It's all going to burn up. It's like his whole life, God's going to destroy all that. See that there? Now, you ever see what's happening here? Look in chapter 4. Look at chapter number 4 here. Watch this. Look at verse 5. Chapter 4 and verse 5 of 1 Corinthians. It says, therefore, judge nothing before the time. This is chapter 4, verse 5. Therefore, judge nothing before the time. What time? That is the judgment seat of Christ. Until the Lord come. That's when it's going to happen. When the Lord comes for us, he's going to take us to the judgment seat of Christ. Watch what's going to happen. Who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness. Well, he's going to use the Word of God to do that. Which that's what the Word of God is able to do right now in our life. You don't need to wait to the judgment seat of Christ to get rid of the things that are inappropriate in our life. It says, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the hearts. The Word of God does that now. On Tuesday night, we're asking the question on our Zoom Bible studies, how to prepare for the judgment seat of Christ? Well, do you know it's coming? Did God give you the textbook ahead of time? So is it going to wind up being an open book test? So do you have all the answers? So how do we prepare for it ahead of time? Study and practice. Life is the stage to learn how to let the Word of God work in us and bring about the gold, silver, precious stones. That's what life is. Whatever you're experiencing right now in your life, whatever you've experienced the last week, month, whatever, that is the opportunity. Some of you all have been through very, very difficult times and are still going through very difficult times just with life. And as you journey through that, as you walk through those experiences, you walk through letting the Word of God be your resource. And you experience tribulation worketh patience. And patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed. The Word of God will not let you down. Why? Because the love of God is shed abroad in your heart by the Holy Ghost that is given unto us. Life is the opportunity to prepare for that exam. Can I say it that way? And you realize, even if the first thing you do every morning when you wake up and you open those eyes and you say, thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving my soul, you got your day off to a fantastic start. Now, what happened afterward might change the course of that day, but the very start. When you go to bed at night, you lay your head on that pillow and you sing, thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation, so rich and free, free. Well, you ended the day on a pretty good note too, right? Just those moments in life where you can kind of stop the madness, the craziness out there. And just for a couple of moments, quote a passage of Scripture, think about the Lord. I hope dear sister Brenda won't mind me if I talk about her dear husband Joe. One of the things he said, maybe this is a week or two before he went home to be with the Lord. I think we were on the phone, and we were there at the house. He said, and you'll remember you were there. He said something along the lines that, boy, I used to think of the Lord all the time. And he said, I'm just finding in my mind I'm maybe not so much anymore. He was quite concerned about that okay, is something happening? Am I thinking, well, yeah, your body's failing, but Christ isn't failing. And you may not be thinking about him every second of every single day like you were, but he is thinking about you. And which would you rather have? To know he's thinking about you. And though our thoughts and though our heart wanders, his never does. You're always on his mind. Always. Just to live. Yeah, praise God to that for that. Amen. You know, look at this passage. Stay there. Look at chapter 4, verse 5. He says, therefore, judge nothing before the time until the Lord come. Here's what he's going to do. who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the heart. And then shall every man, even you, me, have praise of God. That's not us praising God, though we will do that. That's God praising us. We will be presented holy and without blame in his presence. God is going to say, he's going to point to the Lord Jesus Christ and point to the body of Christ and said, look what my son did. And he's going to present us. In fact, the son is actually going to present us to himself and then to the Father. And the Father and the Son and God the Holy Spirit are going to be utterly, as it were, impressed, if I can say it that way. I realize God, you know, he doesn't think like we do, but it's like God is just going to go, wow, look at my dear beloved Son, the new creature, perfectly conformed to the image of my Son, holy and without blame in God's presence forever. When we go through challenges and difficulties this side of glory, and we do, and we will, is it helpful to remember these verses? Why? Why is it helpful? What does it do? Everybody hear what Barry said? Mm-hmm. Good. What else? Anyone else? Sue says it helps stabilize our mind, and then we can renew our mind and our heart. What else? Why else is it? What, still? It gives us sound thoughts. We can think clearly, objectively. Why else? Why is this so helpful? Say that in. We live in a present evil world that denies all of this. Elaine, you said something. Wow, that's a big one. Does anybody need comfort? Does this provide comfort? You know, David, what'd you say? It comforts our thoughts and our hearts. Doesn't it do that? How is the big man doing, Garrett? How's he doing after surgery? Yeah. So for those that don't know, you know, was it last weekend? I think it was Saturday night. Garrett and Lori decided they were going to come up with a plan to get more glory. And they said, you know what? I think I'm going to just go to the hospital because I'm going to go get surgery and on purpose go get a lot of pain because I know that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared. So we're going to come up with a plan to get eternal glory. That's not exactly how it happened, right? Right, but they did wind up in the hospital. He had to have surgery, right? He was in a lot of pain. I think you said it was from Tuesday or Wednesday forward or Thursday, something like that. Poor guy didn't get any sleep almost, what, for like 3 or 4 nights because he doesn't sleep anyway, but he, you know. bad, really bad. Yeah. All right. Yeah, yeah. We have a member of the assembly we'd like to auction off to another assembly. So you won't bring duct tape for him. Yeah. So we had to have that emergency gallbladder surgery, right? Which you had a few years ago, too, right? It was probably not a lot of fun, I'm guessing, right? No, not fun at all. So I'm guessing y'all probably had opportunities to rejoice in Christ and realize, hey, you know what? It's just the outer man. Let's trust God's word. God didn't do this to us. God isn't mad at us. God didn't make this happen to Garrett. God's not trying to teach him a lesson. None of that. That's what religion says. Some difficulty in life, oh, God is trying to get you. God is trying to tell you something. No, that's all superstition. What we do, whatever the situation is, we make a conscious choice. Okay, I know what this is. It's my body. It's failing. This is happening. You go to the doctors. They do the surgery. But all through that, you can walk by faith, resting in Christ. He's our life, our hope. All of that is going to demonstrate it to be at the judgment seat of Christ, gold, silver, and precious stones. It's exactly what that is. Right now. Right here, this life. You know that's coming. You prepare for it. How? Study the scripture, get the scripture in you, and then in life, make a conscious choice in the details, just to walk by faith, just to walk in such a marvelous relationship that you have to the Almighty Living God as your precious Abba Father. God is not following you around in your life trying to make your life miserable, trying to, as they say, wreck your party. God wants you to enjoy Him. Let's close with this one verse here. And there's so much more yet to say about this, but look over to a passage here in Romans 5. Romans 5, a little phrase here that we want to think about. Romans 5, a little phrase in verse 11. It says this. It says, and not only so, but we also, what are the next three words?
Joy
in God. What does that mean? What is demanded in the nature of the relationship that we have with God in order for Him to use a phrase like that? Rejoicing in Christ. If we joy in God, what has to be true about the relationship? Yeah, peace. Excellent. Good, good. We have peace with Him. What else? We have an awareness of that relationship. He loves us. He made us accepted in the beloved. What else? To joy in God. Is God going around following you trying to find fault with everything you do and say? Not if He's using a phrase like that. The God of religion is the God always going around like this. And you know what He's holding back here? He's holding a baseball bat to whack you over the head when you don't obey Him just perfectly. That's religion, friends. That's not the God of grace. To joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received, we've already received the atonement, to joy in Him. Our gracious God and Father, we thank You for the time that we could spend looking in Your Word today that teaches us such marvelous things about Your glorious work, what You are doing collectively in the body of Christ as a whole, the church, the body of Christ as a whole, and then individually in each and every one of us, and doing it for Your glory, for Your honor. And it is to that end that we give Thee thanks and praise in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.